We can
start. Yeah, I think we can start.
Yeah, we are good to go. And it's quite good to hear you.
Okay, we've divided this class into four different sections. One, I'll just talk about fear and greed, right? The basic emotions you feel while you're trading in a market and how to overcome them. Secondly, we'll talk about what risk is and how do we actually look at risk while you're trading. Thirdly, we'll talk about why your returns don't really matter at a beginning stage, especially when it comes to trading. And in the end, we'll talk about the zone or what your mentality should be while you trade. Okay? So let's start with fear and greed. Luckily, we've covered this before in another call. So once people, I'll repeat the exact same example. When a trade is going well and then something bad happens, right? If your trade was in 40 points of profit, now it's in 10 points of profit, you people have this tendency to get really scared and exit those trades, right? But when the trades are doing really badly, they enter a trade, it falls by 40 points immediately. People get really scared. People get really hopeful instead, and they keep holding on to those trades. So this is something which plagues almost every single beginner trader, and this is something you have to flip. If your trade is in a profit, whether in a small profit or a small loss, let those trades run. Let those trades run and make sure your winners have to be far, far bigger than your losers. This is one way how you can judge how good or bad you're getting at trading. Right? So for example, if you're trading with one lot, in the first 6 months of trading, your best day ever was you made a 5K gain, and your worst day was you lost 5K. If in the next half, you've made 8 but lost 6, I'm talking about your biggest green days and your worst red days, the gap should keep on increasing. Your best days should make you a lot more money than your worst days should. Right? And this is repeatable year after year. And as your sample size increases, the more winners you have, the better your entire percentage will be. You can go through time and you can look at any investor you really like. Whether you look at Rakesh Jhunjhunwala, right? The Indian guy, he converted 2 crore rupees to 20 crore rupees in one single day. That he calls that the biggest day of his life. It was some budget and everyone was bearish. He was bullish. And his net worth went up from 2 CR to 20 CR. Or whether you look at George Soros. So again, the guy who crashed the Bank of England or whatever. In both these cases, and in every single case of a trader, you will find these outlier days, which lead to a lot of their wealth. Now, obviously, in the beginning, it doesn't mean that they were all holding on to their winners or they had the capacity to, but it's something you have to develop over time. What I can say with a certain amount of confidence is if you look at any profitable trader, look at his entire month's P&L and take away his top 10 days, there's a high chance that he might have just broken even or actually have been in a loss. It's just those 10 days out of the entire year which have made him a ton of money. So it's very important for you guys to have the right mentality. Suppose like this budget day, for instance, did anybody trade this budget day? Did anybody make 15K per lot? Because that's all you had to do. The budget day started, it was a gap up opening. And even if you've taken a long position in the first half an hour and held on to that trade, you would have made 15K per lot. So 15K, if you have one lot, that's probably the amount of money you lose in an entire month. So that one day could have made up for quite a bit. If you deal with more lots, it could have made your year. Right? So you have to develop yourself, your mentality in such a way that you have the ability to hold on to your winners. One thing which you can do is never look at a P&L. If you're trading in options, especially, like most of you are, what you can do is don't really calculate where your option is at. You bought the option at 60. Okay, you know that because you set a buy order at that level. Now stop calculating. Just let those trades run. Just look at the charts. What are the charts telling you? If your trade is still in a profit and if it's still moving upwards, let it be there. Don't look at the charts and see that, oh, you know what? I'm currently in 900 rupees of profit. Let me go up to 1,000 rupees of profit and then I'll exit. Yeah, that 1,000 rupees is an arbitrary number. And even if you have a pump after that 1,000 rupees, suppose your P&L jumps from 900 rupees all the way to 1,500. You'll have a hard time exiting that trade then. And if there's a dump, you might just have to exit 800. But you won't be able to because, you know, you had 1,000 there right in front of you beforehand. So it'll be extremely hard to exit. Numbers, especially P&L, can have a big impact on the way you trade. All of this is completely pointless because none of that influences the charts, how much money you're making. All you should be really focused at is just looking at the charts and what they are telling you. If you are in a profit, hold on to your trades. That's fine. Be okay with taking losses. Understand that losses are part of the game and that they will happen. But when you win, try to win big. Whether it's a swing trade or any single trade. Especially if you're buying options or something of that sort. Make sure that when you win, you are able to hold on to those trades. Any questions here?
I have one question. You said no need to look at P&L, but just look at the chart, the underlying. But the problem with buying an option is at times, even if the underlying is growing, the option is falling because of the IV crush. So that is one reason that prompts.
So you can look at WIG separately, right?
Right.
So you can look at WIG separately. I don't want your P&L to affect the way you trade. So for example, I'm currently trading, I'm at 9,000 bucks. You know, you have this mentality, you keep hearing it on the Discord server the entire time. I can't wait for 5 digits. 5 digits is a good profit. You know, as soon as you hit 10K, that's a good day. That's completely pointless. Don't really calculate what exactly is happening. And obviously you will have certain cases where, you know, you enter a position and the option doesn't really behave as expected. The Nifty went up by, Nifty went up by 100 points. And you expect your option to go up by 50, but instead it just went up by 30. But that's fine, you know? You can ignore all of that. All you basically have to do is just look at the charts and what they're telling you, not the number at the end of the screen. I think one extremely good tip which beginners should use and something which I personally use as well, I don't even know how much money I've made or lost until the end of the day, until I've closed all my trades. And I used to have something like this, like if I look at my P&L, I exit my trade immediately and that's it. I can't trade anymore. So I used to have a bunch of rules. I still do. I have a bunch of rules lined up, which is based on the way I trade. Because I know that if, suppose I make 3K per lot in one day. If I make 3K per lot, since that's a big number for me and my style of trading, I go into pretty much YOLO mode. I don't really care. I'll just buy some random option. And even if I lose money, it's fine for me because, you know, I've already made 3K per lot. So stuff like that. So you have to avoid all that. Right?
Right. So you suggest to not look at P&L until the end of day.
Don't look at P&L at all. I even know some traders who, you know, hide their, they put tape on the screen where the P&L is. So they aren't able to look at it at all. Yeah.
Oh, that's nice.
Yeah, extreme measures, but loads of full-time traders, they have to take all these steps, right? Because they can't really afford to lose or make mistakes that way.
That's good to know. I think I am going to do that.
Yeah. Now, another thing which you can apply here, it somewhat goes back to what our last call was about, the strategies thing. While you are writing down your strategies, when you're looking at the candles, you can write down what you feel as well. So I personally have a big problem with emotions. Most of my biggest losses have happened because of emotions and not because of a lack of knowledge, right? Obviously, I'm not saying I have knowledge or anything of that sort. I'm saying that I've lost the most amount of money because of overtrading, because of getting angry, because of taking random trades, because of buying, completely shitty out-of-the-money options at like 1 or 2 rupees or 10 rupees or 20 rupees, hoping it'll make up for my day's gain or my week's loss or whatever. Most of my losses, at least 90%, have been because of emotions, especially in my initial days. And it still happens. So please avoid them at all costs. If you feel some sort of emotion kicking in, I think it's best for you to just stop trading for that particular day. It doesn't really matter. We'll get to why in part 3. But just understand, let your trades run. Don't really close them early. And don't really get influenced by any other factor. If the chart is telling you to hold on, just hold on to the trade. Don't be afraid of your trade, which was initially at 100 rupees profit and now it has fallen down. It doesn't matter. Just look at the charts. So if you've gone long on a day, right, and you're pretty bullish and now the market starts to dip, it's fine unless the day's low is broken or an important resistance level is broken or an important pivot point is broken. Don't exit your trade wherever you've set your SL as. Unless that is triggered, don't exit your trade. Okay? And I think I explained in the last call as well that your SLs have to be placed in a manner so that if they are triggered, it means the trend probably changed. So the way I trade, I don't really know what the markets are about to do. What I basically try to figure out is what kind of day do I think it'll be? Do I expect it to be a ranging day? Do I expect it to be a trending day, an uptrending day, or a flat day? Or, you know, something gentle of that sort. And I just take positions accordingly. Even Shameless Steel was saying something on the group yesterday that I just sell calls when the market is on top, and I'll just sell, I'll sell puts when the market is at the bottom. That's not really true. It depends on the kind of market it is. So, for example, if you look at Nifty right now, over the past couple of weeks, right, you can see from the chart, I know where SGX is right now, it might just break the day's high, but so far, what Nifty has shown is that it is in a range. So, every time the market goes up, I think there's a good chance that the markets will correct downwards, because that's what the general trend has been. And every time the markets fall down, there is a tendency for them to pick up again, right? And unless this trend is broken, this ranging market will continue. Now, when the market is just pumping all the way upwards, most of my trades will be skewed towards buying calls or something. Because markets have a tendency, if the markets are moving upwards and that's the trend they're showing, unless I'm proven wrong, that is what will be followed. Makes sense? This ranging market thing makes sense?
Yeah.
Okay, part two, let's move on to risk. Let's move on to what risk is. So how do you guys define risk is extremely important. So loads of people mess this up. I think I wrote this in the chat as well. But just imagine you're playing Russian roulette. And 1,000 times, and there are 1,000 chambers in this hypothetical gun, and just one of them has a bullet. Would you play that game? Each time you win $1,000, right? Maybe you win 1 lakh rupees each time you survive. Would you play that game?
No,
if you win 1 lakh rupees each time, the probability is completely in your favor, right? What's the chances of you succeeding? 99.9% or something of that sort. But you still can't play that game, because if you fuck up, you're done. You've blown your account. You're gone. You're dead. However, in trading, I see multiple people doing the same thing again and again. They go for strategies which have the tendency to blow up their accounts. That is what risk is. So you have to make sure that no matter what your lot size is, no matter the way you're trading is, you have to make sure that no matter what happens, you will not blow up your account. This leads us very nicely to part three, which is your returns don't matter. Especially initially, unless you've completed 3 years of trading, the amount of money you've made doesn't really matter. Whether you've made 80% or whether you've made 20% or whether you've made zero, whether you're on a loss, it doesn't really matter. All that matters is have you survived. So in trading, most of what people call price action is basically just intuition. Right? You watch this across every single sport, whether you're playing chess or whether you're playing anything else. Watch what chess players play bullet. Right? They make these amazing moves in a 1 minute game. Do you think they're calculating everything? Not really. It's based on intuition. It's because they've seen those patterns repeat themselves over and over and over again. It's not exactly something they studied, but it's something they've seen multiple times. And it's the same thing with charts as well. Your entire goal is to just sit there in front of the screen and absorb knowledge all day long. Just understand what the markets are doing. Just look at the patterns. Let your subconscious do the work for you. And once you're trading, that will automatically give you an indication of what the markets might just do. Right? So understand what your risk is properly. Too many people mess this up and too many people blow up their accounts. So if you guys are looking at Keshav Rao, so he made a big mistake. He has a 2K account or something. He tripled it or something of that sort. And now in the last couple of days, he's been trading with he has 3 different positions open. The problem here is there is a chance for his account to go all the way down to 0. So does it matter whether he went from 2K and then tripled his account? whether he tripled his account or no doesn't matter, because the way he's playing the game, there will be one bad day and he will go down to zero. So there's absolutely no point of what his returns are, because the amount of risk he's taking is extremely large. So make sure the amount of risk you take is minimal. Your returns do not matter initially. All that matters is repetition. Make sure you sit in front of the charts. Make sure you take breaks. If you ever feel like, you know, this is not for you or something of that sort, take a week off. Take a week off and then get back at it. Taking breaks is actually extremely beneficial because your mind gets a break, so it can absorb the information properly and analyze it properly. It is extremely important. Plus, on the days when you take breaks, you don't lose any money and you're still looking at the screen. So you're gaining knowledge automatically, but you aren't paying for it. However, the flip side is you can't really take too many breaks as well. Usually, whether you're smoking or something of that sort, doctors do recommend it takes 3 days to break a habit, at least the initial cycle. So never skip trading 3 days in a row. I mean, unless something happens or you want to take a longer break. But if you are sitting in front of a desk all day long and there's nothing out of the ordinary happening to your schedule, 2 day breaks are fine. But on the third day, do try to trade again. Right? Anything confusing so far? Any questions?
No, I think it's clear.
Okay, this is probably the most important thing when it comes to trading, especially. Understand that it's all probability. Understand that nobody knows what the markets will do. So all that matters is a discipline. That's it. It doesn't matter how intelligent you are. It doesn't matter what you know about the markets. All that matters is, do you make mistakes? Do you make mental blunders? Now, to all of you guys, I can pretty much guarantee, go through your entire trade book, go through all of your loss-making days and your profit-making days, and write down why you lost money that day. I'm pretty sure on your worst days, it will probably be some mental error. And not that you read the charts wrong. There'll probably be something like this. You usually traded one lot, but because you had a loss, you started trading with two lots, or maybe something went well, you moved up to two lots, and then you lost so much money, which is why you had that big red day. Most mistakes are mental. This is the most important part of trading. I'm repeating this again and again. So make sure you are in a sort of zone. Another thing I would recommend is you guys should try meditating, or at least being in some sort of a zone. There's a book by Mark Douglas, Trading in the Zone. Right? You can read what that guy has to say as well. And plus, in every trading psychology book, every single one, you will come across this term, maybe in different words, but the meaning is the same. Let's go back to sports again. So if you ever see anybody before a game, right, or before a fight, we just had the UFC 259. You can probably see the guys before the game, before the fight, they're all pumped up. They're shouting, they're screaming, they're looking at the crowds. But once they step in, they're calm. They aren't really doing much in the cage. So when they're in the game, they're just focused on what they've already done beforehand, and nothing is really bothering them. Whether the crowd is cheering for them, whether they make a shot, whether they miss a shot, it doesn't really matter. Because they are in the zone. They are just reacting to the information being thrown at them, and they're reacting to it based on whatever they've learned in practice. Right? So that's what being in a zone is. You shouldn't face any emotions when you trade. You've got to be pretty emotionless. And if you have trouble with being emotionless, if you have problems when you get extremely happy or you get extremely sad or you face any emotion at all, take deep breaths, meditate, listen to a song, get out of the room, take a walk, do something else, get out of the zone, and then step back in. Okay, so I think I've covered most of it. If you guys have any questions, there was some guy who wanted to ask doubts about some book that he was reading. Any questions, any doubts? Palika, what do you mean? Getting personal? What? I don't get it.
I think he meant to say that you are touching a nerve with him. Like, you are exactly touching the points that he undergoes.
Okay.
Yeah, you mentioned that your big days or green days should be much higher as compared to your red days. But what do you suggest to someone like me who has 4 consecutive green days, let's say for 1,000 rupees each, and then I have a red day where I lose like 4 to 8K in a day. And I'm back to square one.
No, that's fucked. You've got to change that. Because
I'm in the zone for like 4 out of 5 days, but there will be one day where I'll fuck up and my account will be like the same as before the week. So it's a problem with me. Yeah, since the first day of trading.
The thing here is, this is similar to scalping. So what scalpers basically do is, I'm talking about the algos. People usually suck at scalping. I don't think people can successfully scalp. I haven't met a single successful scalper in my life. But what these HFTs do is, for scalping, their stop loss is pretty wide. Their stop loss could be like 1 5-minute candle. And they will book profits at like 2 points, 3 points, 4 points, something. So their stop loss is maybe say 10 points. But they will take profits whenever they get like, so a stop loss of 10 and a profit booking at 2. So these guys have to be profitable 80% of the time to make money, which is fine for an algorithm to do, but for a human to get that success rate is insane. So this is exactly what's happening with you. If you have like 8 consecutive good days, but then you have one bad day, you're back to zero.
Right.
So your probability, your probability rate is 80%. According to me, it's probably around 50 to 55 to 60%, somewhere in that range. 50 to 60 is reasonable. Anything over that, you're a great trader.
Hey, Energizer, one question. How long do you persist with a strategy? Like, do you change strategy after, say, 2-3 days consecutive losses, or like 1 week consecutive losses? Or how is it? Like, when is the time to give up on a strategy?
So once you've tested a strategy across all market cycles, there's absolutely no reason to stop using it. If you've backtested it across all cycles and you know that over the past 12 years, the success rate of this strategy has been, let's say, 60%. And now you've had, say, 20 consecutive trading sessions, which is one entire month of losses. It doesn't really mean much in the grand scheme of things, right? Think of it as a biased coin. You have a coin, it can go heads or tails, right? Now, the probability of it being, let's say, 60%. That doesn't mean that every first time you have a head. Right? You can have 5 straight days in a row. So it depends on how backwards you tested the strategy for. If it's something new, then you can probably stop. But once you've done it properly, then you can keep continuing unless something major happens. And another thing, once you've made a strategy, it doesn't mean that you just stop looking at it completely, right? You have to analyze your trades every single day. So even for analyzing, I analyze my trades twice a day, once immediately after the session ends, immediately afterwards. So at 3:30, I will spend 10 minutes usually just going through my trades, what I did, because everything is fresh in my mind, right? Because I know how I felt. So for example, I took one good trade and then I exited at, let's say, 50 Nifty points and exited that trade. But then Nifty went up by another 200 points. So what happens at 3:30 is I remember my emotions properly. Why I exited at 50 points is because I got scared. So I note that down, or at least I make a mental note of it. And this is why I exited. So if I see these conditions again, or the market breaks out from a lower range or something, or the markets keep going up, are going upwards, let's not exit trades early. Because if it captured 250 points, that would have made up for 5 days of losses. Right? So what that guy is doing, the guy we just mentioned, he makes $1,000 a day, but then he loses 8K a day. Right? Imagine if it was inversed. That when he loses $1,000, but when he wins money, he wins 8K. So if he has 8 straight days of losses, it's fine because just one day and he'll make enough money. That's far, far better.
When you actually encounter losses, what I usually do is I kind of hold it for long term, like more than how much I expected in order to reduce those losses. What do you think that's...
No, you've got to cut your losses short, right? You have to cut your losses short.
Like, what are
so if you have a set stop loss, let it hit your stop loss. Never, ever change the stop loss. Unless you're an expert trader, don't change the stop loss. Unless you're an expert trader, don't enter positions again. Or, you know, add more lot size. Don't average down. Don't do any of that stuff. Keep it extremely simple. As I mentioned, part three, your returns absolutely do not matter in the first 3 years. All that matters is that you survive. And starting from the... Because in trading, you can make quite a bit of money. With 10 lots, if you are a decent trader, and if you're capturing like 10 Nifty points every single day, that's it, 10 Nifty points. So what I mean by 10 Nifty points is probably on a good day you capture 30 points, and when you lose, you probably lose 15 points, right? That seems reasonable. That's not something crazy, right?
Kind of, yeah.
You will make 1 lakh in that month. That's it. I'm talking about 10 lots. 10 lots could be, 10 lots is basically an account size of, let's say, 4 lakh rupees. That's all. 4 lakh rupees is all you need to make 1 lakh rupees per month, as long as you know what you're doing. Obviously, maybe you aren't there yet, but you can get to that level. So you just have to survive. Just keep trading, keep looking at the charts, it'll come to you. Keep looking at your mistakes and it'll come to you. You don't really need anything else. Yeah?
Right. So just like be in the game for like 1 year or 2 years before actually...
Yeah, we'll be in the game. Yes.
Yeah.
Again, you can look at chess as an example. If you guys have heard of Laster, he was the longest reigning chess champion for 30 years or something. He was world number one. And at those times, you didn't have computers. You didn't really have a ton of books either. You didn't really have that literature. So how did these guys improve? How did these guys get so good? All that guy did was he kept playing chess and he kept analyzing his games. Whether he won or he lost, he kept analyzing his games. And he got better. Oh, trading in the zone. Yeah, I mean, if you search for trading psychology books, right, it'll probably come up at number one.
Oh,
I think it's by Mark Douglas, but I'm not completely sure. Trading in the zone. Okay. You'll find it easy. Yeah.
Cool. I'll check it out.
If you guys like philosophy, then you can also read Nassim Taleb's books. So they are a lot more philosophical, but they talk about the exact same points, right? So that guy is a hedge fund manager now. He's considered one of the greatest minds in trading. And the way this guy trades is pretty unique in the sense that he doesn't really think about making money. That's not his goal. His goal is just to limit his losses. So before entering a trade, he doesn't really look at how much money can I make here? What my target will be? All he looks at is, what is my stop loss here? What's the worst possible outcome? If I go long here, what's the worst possible outcome? The worst possible outcome is the markets fall still here. Okay, that's my stop loss. Is that fine for me? Good. Take that trade. That's it. So what Nassib has seen over time is he has generated fairly low returns throughout his life. He hasn't really... been the kind of guy who's doubled his money in a year or anything of that sort. And he's seen traders in front of him double their money during bull runs and stuff. Especially in the dot-com bubble, the period following that bubble from 2008 onwards, 2020, 2019 actually. You know, in that period, he's seen people make so much money. However, in the crashes, they all get bankrupt and they lose their jobs in front of him. So when these guys are rising up, when he was working in a company, those guys would get all the bonuses because they were the ones who were making exceptional returns. They had all the hot stocks in their portfolios and he didn't. However, he lasted in the game. He's still here and he's still rich. The other guys, they were extremely rich for a while. They all had Ferraris and Lamborghinis. But then eventually one day, the Reaper came, their Russian roulette failed and they went bankrupt. You don't want that guy to be you. Right? So start looking at risk differently. So you can read both Read Trading in the Zone by Mark Douglas, and you can read Nassim Taleb's book. He's got multiple, I think.
Cool. Check that.
Earlier you were talking about that you have multiple trading strategies, like 10 or 12 setups, but you also mentioned that we should stick to a setup for a while, like unless we don't try it enough, then you won't get the average out. So how do you decide between which setup you are going to use that day? Because what happened with me earlier was that because I was using multiple setups, and today I was using A and second day I was using B, and because of like switching between the multiple setups, I was trading only the losses once on the individual trades. Hence, I was a net loss.
I mean, you need a larger sample size. So in any data set, anything less than 30 is not considered sample size.
Yeah.
So you can take the same thing in trading. So 1.5 months of losses is still, you know, nothing really.
Not 1.5 months. I'm talking about, like, as you said, you have multiple trading strategies. So how do you decide while you're in the market that, okay, today I'm going to apply this strategy over the other one so that I will be profitable?
Okay, so it's basically something like this. So in current markets, I'm not counting what SGX is doing right now. It'll probably be a gap of opening tomorrow. Maybe if the markets break the zone, something else might happen. And if that happens, I probably won't trade because I don't know what the trend is. Right?
Yeah.
So far, the markets have been ranging. So since the markets have been ranging, I had that information with me already. The markets are currently deciding whether they want to go to 16,000 or whether they want to fall to 14,000. We've all had this feeling, I guess.
Yes.
This isn't complicated.
Yeah.
So now all I'm looking at is to get the best risk-to-reward ratio, I should probably sell when the markets are higher and I should probably buy when the markets are lower.
Easy? All right. Yes.
So what I'm basically doing is going against the trend. When the markets will go up, I will sell. When the markets fall down, I will buy. Whatever the range is, if the market touches the topmost range, I will sell. The market touches the bottom range, I will buy. So basically, I'm taking reversals here. I just have two reversal strategies. That's it.
Okay.
So I just have to pick between them. And most of my strategies are trend following. Right? As of before, I've lost a lot of money in taking reversal trades. And I'm still not that great. So especially at like taking random reversal trades, I still end up at a loss, I think, at 70% of the time in that instance. So which is why when the markets are ranging like this, I usually limit the number of trades I have and I stick to my two strategies. That's all.
Okay. And one more thing about stop losses. What usually happens with me is that I'm very strict about my stop loss, but I have usually no idea what my target is. Like sometimes I decide that I'll take 1:1. Sometimes I decide I'll take 1:2. And whenever I decide I'll trail my stop loss, it usually happens that I exit at cost. And the times when I exit at 1:1, the my trade goes into my favor, target of 1:8, 1:9 when the trades are trending. And then I sit and regret.
Yeah, so don't change it, right? Don't change it. First of all, trailing is pretty important. Some of the expert traders I know, like Soros and everyone, they've mentioned repeatedly that trailing stop losses are a very important part of trading. However, that is something I haven't been able to figure out. And since you're in this mentorship, you're probably relatively new to trading. So I don't think trailing is something you guys should seriously look at.
All right.
Yeah? So don't trail. Let it hit a stop loss. That's fine.
Yeah, but usually I only hit the stop losses. Like out of 10 trades, maybe I'll hit 7 times stop loss. And the 3 times my risk reward is usually 1:1 or 1:2. And hence I'm net in losses. Like when I check my P&L of like the past 9 months, my maximum losses is because of the charges of trades rather than the actual loss amount. Because of multiple trades and usually the more number of stop loss sets.
Yeah, then you're setting your stop losses too tight.
All right.
What's your stop loss usually at? You trade in options or futures?
Yeah, options in Bank Nifty, and usually it's 35 to 40 points.
Yeah, dude, that is nothing. That is nothing.
But
you can't be that exact.
Okay.
I mean, 35 points is one candle, right?
Yes.
35 points is one candle in Nifty. You really know what the next few candles will be?
No, but
I think that's insane if you know what the next candle will be like.
When I initially started, my stop loss used to be 75 to 100. And because of the higher amount, I used to feel like, okay, this is too much loss I can handle. But I remember you telling me about that.
Then reduce the number of trades you take. If, for example, when you take, you're currently trading with a stop loss of 35. For mathematical purposes, let's just keep it at 50. Okay, round number.
Yes.
And currently, let's assume you're taking, let's say, 2 trades a day. Because that's what your account size allows you to do. Instead, make a stop loss 100 and take 1 trade a day. That's all.
Okay. So you're...
And don't change your targets. Don't keep it as 1:1. Let your profits run. Because if you have those... So just think about it in a very simple perspective. I'm sure you must have taken trades where as soon as you enter, you get a big green candle and the trade starts performing. And if you'd held on to that one particular day, you would have made 10K.
Yes, and this has happened like 3 to 4 times.
So one trade which went well would have covered up 1 month of you making losses.
Definitely. But
this is exactly what we spoke about in part one, right?
Yes.
Let those trades run. And even if, let's say 7 out of 10 times, you don't make a ton of money. Okay? So you enter Bank Nifty and Bank Nifty is pumping well. You're currently at whatever. You don't even know the amount, right? Because you've hidden that. You don't know what your P&L is. You just know you're in a good profit right now. That Bank Nifty is up by 200 Bank Nifty points. Just keep holding on to that trade. What's the worst that can happen? Either hit your stop loss, or what's far more likely is if it's such a bullish day, even if there's a correction, you'll probably be able to exit at the end of the day at 3:25 p.m. at, let's say, 25 to 30 points of profit, which is nothing, but that'll pay for brokerage at least. You know?
Yeah.
So you took a trade the entire day, you were looking at the charts, you gained all that knowledge, and you got out of 25 points. Who cares? People are way too scared of this. That if trade goes up, it performs well, you exit your trade, or it falls down somewhat, it falls down by 20 points. Let's say you enter a trade, you've made 100 points of profit. Then it falls down by 50. You're currently at 50 points, you think it's working really well. You exit that trade, and then it works. And then it goes up another 200 points. That one day would have taken care of like 6 bad trades. That one good trade.
Definitely. So how do you...
Add in more nuance, right?
Mm-hmm.
How you can do that is, for example, these bigger trades usually happen when it's a trending day. So for example, the markets go up and they keep going up.
Mm-hmm.
The corrections are pretty small, but they are frequent. So what do the markets need for you to have an uptrending day? Can you figure out within the first hour whether the day will be trending in a particular direction?
No.
I think it is fairly simple. Look at the long-term charts. Look at how the markets have been performing. The markets have all been doing extremely well. And today there was a gap up opening and the markets is moving upwards. However, if you don't have red candles, right? If you don't have red candles sprinkled in regularly, it's extremely hard for that day to be a trending day. Why? Because to have a trending day, you need both buyers and sellers. If the markets keep going upwards, suppose Nifty has gone up by let's say 500 points in the first hour.
Mm-hmm.
Who will sell that market?
No.
Nobody.
Right.
Nobody will sell that market. So what will happen? The price will crash. Because you need sellers for the price to move up. So this is how you know it's going to be a trending day. Nifty is at 14,000 and the day opens. 14,000, half an hour, it has gone up to 14,020. A small correction goes down to 14,010 and then it goes up to 14,030. A small correction goes down to 20 and then it goes to 40. And then you have one random pump and it goes to 14,100. Does this describe some of the days you've seen?
Yes.
Yeah, so when you see those types of days, hold on to your positions. When there are multiple corrections coming in, when you know there are sellers present in this market and they are the ones who will fuel this run upwards, hold on to your trades. However, if there's like a random pump, if there are random pumps coming in, one 50-point pump, another 50-point pump, another 50-point pump, then you can probably exit quicker.
Okay, because
then
they won't sustain.
Make 100 points, just exit your trade and that's it. Yeah.
All right.
Even if it does sustain in that case, it's fine, right? Mm-hmm. Again, the probability is in your favor.
Yes. So, as you were talking about the psychology, and you told that the situation which like most of us are facing, that when the market is in our favor, we feel like exiting. So, how do you cope that feel that whenever we see the green amount and we feel like, okay,
itna to rest lete hain. You shouldn't be feeling anything. It should be like path four. You're in the zone.
Yeah. Okay.
People are screaming, whether the crowd is screaming at you, whether the crowd is shouting at you, or whether they're praising you, it doesn't really matter. All you're focused on is the game. I'm sure you've heard sports commentary, right? The game has slowed down for Virat Kohli. What does that mean? The game has slowed down? He can change time? What does that mean?
No.
It just means so damn calm. Everybody else is worked up around him. Everybody else is experiencing emotions. And he's calm. So he can analyze information faster than anybody else on the field. Because he's calm.
Right.
Make sense?
Yes, definitely.
So always use the real world to help you out of trading.
Mm-hmm.
People do the opposite. You know, they learn something in trading and then they try to apply that to real life. It should be the opposite. Trading is not some crazy new field. It's just people, all just human behavior, right? Why does the markets go up? Because people think it will go up. Correct?
Yes.
Another thing I should mention. So, as I said, for it to be a trending day, you need a steady diet of sellers in the markets. You need there to be some small corrections. You need there to be red candles, and then only you will have a trending day. And if you have multiple green candles, you can expect the trend to stop sometime or the other, because there will be nobody left there to sell, and the market will automatically start falling. There is an exception to this rule, which is fundamental factors. If it's budget day and the markets are moving upwards, you can still take a risk. You know, because even though the budget is being read out right now, so far everything has been positive and the fundamental push is positive. So if a good news comes out about a certain stock like SBI performed well, right? And then they had that crazy gap up opening. In that instance, you can still hold on to trade despite there being multiple green candles because of the fundamental push. Otherwise, you can exit those trades quicker. Okay. Again, it's very counterintuitive. On the most bullish days in the first 1 hour, it's best to exit. But on days where it looks moderately bullish, that's when you should hold on. But do you understand why? Do you understand why it makes sense?
Yes, because since it is a fundamental thing and everybody has their psychology around it, that okay, it has to go up because of a major information. So that's why nobody would sell on that day and then it will go up. No?
Yeah.
Okay. I had a question since you mentioned the budget thing. Would you tell us how did you trade on the 1st of February after, like, what was going on in your mind during that day? Because 1.5 or 2 hours of the initial of the day was like completely flat and then 2,500 points. So,
yeah. So, this is funny, but then remember the big green candle which came on budget day?
Yes.
I think it was somewhere around the afternoon.
Yes.
Yeah. Right before that.
Oh.
Yeah, I didn't have a great budget day.
But as you mentioned that because it is a sentimental day and everybody knew what was happening, and after that first green candle, the market retraced a bit. So did you not find that a good opportunity to enter again?
No, because budget days can be fundamental days can be very volatile, right?
Yes.
And I had bought an option because initially I knew that at least for now, the markets will keep pumping. At least for now. So I just entered my long. I bought an option and then I exited because if it falls down, I've bought options. You know, there's a big possibility of the value of my options just crashing. If I'd sold options on that day, then I would have held on. But I didn't. So I fucked up there. Yeah.
All right. Well, good traders also have a bad day, because the day before everybody were talking about that the volatility will be there, and usually on the budget days the market is never in one single direction. I don't know was because of COVID or something else, but this was a very unique scenario, right? Like the last this kind of day was held on 13th March when the market went 10% down and the trading was closed. So that's why I asked.
Yeah, so the reason for this budget day being volume battle was because it signaled a fundamental shift in Indian politics. This was the biggest, I think, after 1999, when India allowed privatization after pressure from the international communities. I think this was the biggest budget day ever. Because the first time in our history, we've got a government who is openly saying we will support private enterprise. We will stop giving subsidies out. We'll stop helping and giving out money for no reason. Instead, what we'll do is support privatization.
Mm-hmm.
We'll actually encourage privatization. We'll sell off. We'll get out of business. We don't know how to run businesses because who wants to admit they made a mistake? Now, again, with all these government companies that we have, the government makes money. These politicians all get their cut, right?
Right.
If Bale gets a big 10,000 CR order, I'm pretty sure 50% goes off to the middlemen and the politicians and they eat all of it. So why would they let go of their cash? So the same thing has been happening for ages. For the first time ever, these guys are telling us properly, clearly, that we will support private enterprise, we'll get out of business. That's been a great sign.
Okay.
Which is why this budget day was bullish. You can read Jhunjhunwala's interview about this. He went crazy. I mean, it's extremely funny.
Okay.
But yeah, you can read the budget day interviews. Just search on YouTube, Rakesh. I think he had an interview with Shekhar Gupta about the budget.
All right.
He's the Wire guy or...
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
It's on YouTube, I think.
Yeah, it's on YouTube. I saw it on YouTube. Any last questions, guys? It's almost been an hour.
So I had a pretty off-topic question. So how do we mark our progress? Like, how do we decide where do we want to be in a month in terms of progress and trading?
Yeah, what was part three? Your returns don't matter. That's the title, man. Pay attention. Your returns don't matter. Don't set benchmarks. Don't add extra pressure to yourself. Because again, if you keep a target for, let's say, I want to make 10K this month. You know, I have a 1 lakh account. I want to make 10K this month. And what if on the beginning of the fourth week, you're up, let's say you're at 9K. That'll fuck your entire week up because you have a certain target in mind, right? The markets don't know about your targets, but that'll affect the way you trade. Again, you're feeling some kind of emotion. You could be happy that you've already made 9K. You're further ahead of schedule, and maybe you'll take more risks now, right? All the other thing could happen where you're at 9K. You just have to get to one more K. So you'll be extremely conservative, and you'll break your rules. You'll break your rules by not letting your winners run, you know? And that one day what happens, the markets kept going up. You get extremely frustrated because you missed out on a good day and because you broke your rules, you're angry with yourself. And the next day you'll fuck up and lose money. And now you're back to 5K.
So this was in terms of money, like in monetary terms. But we ought to set some goals, right? So what goals
not,
is...
Not in the first 3 years. I don't really think you should be setting any goals at all. Just understand the game. I mean, would you set goals for something like this in any other field? If I started learning chess, would you tell me that in 3 years you should be at this ELO? Or would you tell me just enjoy the game? Just have fun, play around with it. You know, fall in love with the entire process. And sooner or later, you will get there.
Progress. How do I know if I'm making progress or not?
If you're sticking to your rules, that's how you know you're making progress. Okay, this month, I haven't broken any of my rules. I haven't overtraded. When I had a bad position, I exited my trade properly. I let my winners run. And how many times did I lose control? I lost control 5 times, 10 times, 15 times. Reduce that number. You're making progress.
But that's valid for you. You're an experienced trader. We are like starting to...
It's even more valid for you guys because you guys probably make more mental mistakes than I do. Or, I mean, again, don't really want to compare, but beginners usually make more mental mistakes, right?
Yeah.
So this is even more valid for you guys. Don't make mental mistakes. That's how you can measure progress for now. Don't really look at the whole numbers because anything can happen. Your sample size is so small. You've been trading for 6 months. If you have like a great month where you make like 1 lakh rupees from a 1 lakh account, it could be all because of luck. Does it have to be your skill? No, right? It could be luck. Who knows? You flip the coin 10 times, it just heads all 10 times. Who knows? So how can you really make proper assumptions here? Just stick to your trading rules and that's when you know you're making gains, you're moving ahead. you're reading the charts better. You are understanding, you're picking up whether today will be a range bound or a trending day. Okay, yesterday was 5 days out of the month where I knew what kind of day it would be within the first hour or within the first couple of hours. So you can set goals that way. Yeah.
Okay, cool. Thanks.
One more thing, I had a question about position sizing. As because of the rules now, one lot of future and one lot of selling an option is costing close to 95,000 to 1 lakh in Bank Nifty. So would you suggest to rather buy options which are close to ATM of monthlies, or would you still suggest that it would be rather better to go for futures or selling options?
Okay, so there are two questions here. One, the first question is, when should you buy, when should you sell, right?
Yeah.
Whether I buy an option or I sell an option depends on the premium.
Yes.
So 3 months ago, even longer, I think back in November, premium completely dried up.
Yes, it was very low.
So I had to switch to buying, which is somewhat new to me because I usually sell options. That's what I'm used to. Because, you know, before COVID, the markets are usually calmer. So that's what I'm used to. But then when premium dried up and I wasn't making as much money, I had to switch to buying. So that's when you switch between buying and selling. You look at the premium in the markets and then you trade based on that. If there's enough premium, sell. Always sell. But if there's absolutely no premium, there's no point of selling. You have to buy. You're being forced to buy.
Okay.
Yeah. Now, and, when it comes to which, your second question was, which strike price should I select?
Mm-hmm.
Right? So I select my strike prices based on where I expect the markets to go. So again, I expect it to be a trending day. Okay, Nifty is currently at 14,000. I expect it to be a trending day. So I might just buy 14,200 or something. You know?
Yeah.
And hold that and keep. If it doesn't work, it doesn't work. My analysis is wrong. It's fine. But that's what I usually do. Now, if I'm not sure about the markets, I might change it again. So it depends on your conviction, what the success rate of this particular thing will be today. What do you think it'll be? Yeah, you can choose your strike prices based on that. If you are like 50-50, then just choose whatever is at the money. Yeah, but I think that's still a bit advanced. For now, you can just stick to ATMs. It doesn't really matter.
All right. Mm-hmm. I asked this question because when during the COVID times, like until November, the selling cost was not as much high. Like even when Bank Nifty reached all-time high, the selling cost was like only 45, 50,000. Now it's 1 lakh. And I guess in 2-3 months, it will be 1.6 or 2 lakhs, depending on where Bank Nifty will be. So because the difference between the price, like if you want to buy an option, it will cost only like maybe 20,000-25,000. So you can buy at least 4 or 5 lots at the same cost. So the profit and loss will be obviously accordingly that. So that is why I was asking you, would you suggest rather to buy or sell or go for futures?
No. Position sizing remains the same, right? One lot.
One lot refers
to you. It doesn't matter what your round size is.
Okay. And you mentioned about pre-COVID times when the markets were calm. So do you think that we will again ever go back to that, or Bank Nifty will ever stay volatile like this? Because since COVID, people thought that by January it will be fine. But then since February, everything is again like crazy.
Again, I don't really know, right? I'll know later.
All right.
As of right now, I mean, I can't really make any assumptions because think about it this way. It's been a bull market from 7,500 to 15,000.
Yes.
How can I pick the top? As I've mentioned before, it's impossible to pick the tops or the bottoms. So the same, whatever I say, I mean, it doesn't really matter the way you trade. These rules universally apply. Whether it's intraday, I mentioned in terms of intraday trading, in which you can't really pick tops and bottoms. But it happens based on the long-term chart as well. I can't really pick tops and bottoms. I will just keep expecting it to be a crazy bull run market until it crashes.
Okay.
Right? What will happen then is, for example, let's assume the market continues moving up for another year and then it falls down. Random example. At least I'll make money this entire year and then I'll lose money in 1 month. But since I know about Russian roulette, since I know about what risk actually is, I won't lose a shit ton of money.
Right.
Now, think of it. Do you guys know about the dot-com bubble?
Back in 2014?
Back in 2000. 1999-2000.
Yes.
You guys can read about the dot-com bubble. So you had multiple bears in the market. You had so many people who kept shorting the markets because they were absolutely 100% certain that the markets would crash. They were 100% certain. And guess what? They were completely right. They were absolutely right. The markets did crash eventually. But by the time the markets crashed, the bubble lasted for two and a half years. Those guys all went bankrupt. They all went bankrupt because they couldn't keep selling for that long, even though they were completely right. But if the markets are rising, what's the point of selling? Sense?
Yes. You cannot time it right. Even if you're right.
Imagine how those guys felt. They knew that this tech company is a fake company. They hardly make any revenue. Their revenues are still at a loss. And still its stock price is going up. I will sell this. They sold. It doubled in value. They had to close that position. It went up again. They sold that. They shorted the stock. However, it still doubled in value. They had to close that position. So by the time it actually crashed, they had no money left.
Correct.
Hello?
Yeah.
How do you know the long-term trend has reversed?
The long-term trend, when you see it in the chart properly. Easy.
So like monthly, right,
when you see multiple red candles on the longer time frames, you know the market has reversed. I mean, don't you know? Oh, today is an uptrending day. When will the trend reverse? When day is low is broken. Right? And the market keeps falling even lower. So maybe on that one day you'll make a loss, but then later on we'll be fine. It's a game of probability. You won't make money every single day. You will have drawdown months.
Hey, Anajay, so do you think we should use the stop loss as a percentage of your portfolio or just the indicator of your strategy?
Indicator of a strategy. Because percentage of a portfolio doesn't really matter. The markets won't respect that, right? What's the point? The markets don't know how much money you have. That's not a stop loss. Just maximum pain point. Yep. Right? That's not a stop loss at all. Don't call that a stop loss. Just tell people that, you know what? I've entered a position here. My maximum pain threshold is here. So I will exit when it hits my maximum pain threshold because I can't afford to lose anymore. But don't be surprised if the market breaks that level and then performs.
Okay.
Okay, last question. Anything?
Do you think the open interest and option chain are good indicators? Would they be used?
Yeah, they can be useful if you don't read them properly. I don't. So, I don't use them.
Okay.
I get very confused by anything and everything. So, which is why the way I feel is extremely simple. I usually know beforehand what my strike price will be, what my lot size will be. Everything is predetermined. Everything. So in the middle of a trade or, you know, before entering a trade, I don't have to think about anything else except the charts. What are the charts telling me? Everything else is predetermined. Everything else is set in place. The less things I have to calculate, the more accurate I am with the basics. So most of my trades are just based on the long-term picture. They aren't really based on what's happening short-term. I don't really care about the short-term. Okay, guys, I'm pretty tired now. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Good night.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Good night.